Since the beginning of the week, as I have worked on my message, this thing's way too hot today. Since I worked on my message, the old commercial from Dr. Pepper has kept going through my head. Dr. Pepper is friendly pepper-upper, and it never, never, never lets you down. Dr. Pepper is friendly pepper-upper. A, I can't remember what the last line was. How do you remember that, though, that part of it? There we go. I see some hands. All right. What were the numbers that Dr. Pepper used to impress on people? Isn't there advertisements? 10, 2, and 4. 10, 2, and 4. Have you a Dr. Pepper? That's three a day. Do you know how many calories that would be? Do you know if I had three Dr. Peppers a day, I would have to stand back here because I wouldn't get to the pulpit? 10, 2, and 4. Three special numbers. Well, this morning, we're looking at a couple of folks, and if we had lived back in Jesus' time, and if we wanted to do what was ritually required of us, and really, really look good doing it, we would stop everything that we were doing at 9 o'clock. Morning. We would stop anything we were doing at 12 o'clock, straight up noon, and then we would stop at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, three different times in the day, to stop and pray. Now, this was 2,000 some odd years ago. Who does that sound like in our world today that stops in the middle of their day to pray? Our Muslim friends. You know, there's so many times. There are so many times. And those who really wanted to seem way better than everybody else, and those who wanted their prayers to be especially heard and effective to God, they didn't just stop wherever they were at work or in the marketplace or out in the fields. They stopped. They went to the temple. And they did their praying there. And our scripture today, and the parable we find today, is about two men who stopped what they were doing and went to the temple to pray. They went, just like we have come this morning, to speak to God, to speak their hearts to the Lord. And the first one we're going to look at this morning is the Pharisee. And what we need to understand is that the Pharisee really didn't want, or he didn't think that he needed God to do anything for him. In fact, if you look at the Pharisee, if you listen to the words that he spoke, what the Pharisee went to pray for was so that he could stand up and he could look upward. And he could toot his own horn about how good he was. I suspect if the Pharisee left church at 9:30, 12:30, and 3:30, I suspect his arm was tired from patting himself on the back. And he surely hoped that God heard how wonderful he was. But more than that, he wanted the rest of the people there to hear how good he was. The Pharisee, just in case God missed it, he made it perfectly clear. He listed for God the things that he did. He tithed everything, which was much more than what Jewish law called for. He fasted three times a week. That's two more times than he had to, according to Jewish ritual. And oh my word, God, I hope you don't forget that, because I really am a very good person. And in this listing of the good things he did, he got it all out and he gave it to God. And then, just in case God wasn't paying real close attention, he listed the bad things that he wasn't doing. You know, he went and he said, I'm not an adulterer, I'm not a thief, I'm not a rogue, I'm not even like him. the tax collector. And can't you just hear that Pharisee say the word him? Now, I can't make my upper lip curl like Elvis could, but I can see on this guy's face that I am not like him. So, what he was, what his prayer was with God, it was an advertisement for himself, so that God would realize just how wonderful this man was. In essence, if you cut to the chase, in essence, the Pharisee was reading his own resume the way he had written it. And he was handing it upward and over to God and selling himself to God. And how much did God buy into it? That's the wonderful thing about the God that we worship, is his wisdom and his knowledge and all that he has. And God declared that the Pharisee prayed with himself. He didn't pray with God. He didn't get God's attention by all of this that he was doing. The Pharisee was over here by himself, the Bible tells us. And he was praying totally with himself. He came to church, to temple, at 9 and at 12 and at 3, strictly to inform God of how good he was, because he just didn't want God to miss it. The famous actor Gregory Peck, many years ago, was once standing in line at a very, very nice Los Angeles restaurant, and he was standing in line waiting for a table. They had been waiting in line for quite some while, and the diners seemed to be really taking their time, and new tables were not opening up, and nobody was moving. There was nobody going out, there was nobody going in, and they weren't even close to the front of the line. The man with Gregory Peck kind of got impatient, and he said to Gregory Peck, "Why don't you just go over there and tell the maitre d' who you are? Because he'll know who you are, and you'll get to go ahead of everybody else in front of us." And Gregory Peck looked at the man and responded with great wisdom. "No," he said, "if you have to tell people who you are, then you are not." Now think about that. If you have to tell people who you are, then you're not. Obviously, that's a lesson the tax collector never learned. He was way too interested in his own self and making sure that God knew who he was. I just said tax collector, didn't I? I meant to say Pharisee. The tax collector, on the other hand, did not have to tell God who he was, because he knew who he was. The tax collector knew his own heart when he said, "Be merciful to me, a sinner." Now, in our faith tradition, we don't have much in our hymnal, or we don't have a book of worship that includes a whole lot of prayers of asking for forgiveness and admitting our sins. That's not part of our tradition. But what is part of our tradition is the knowledge of God's word that no matter how good we are, we fall short of the glory of God. We may be like the Pharisee. We're not thieves, we're not rogues, we're not chainsaw murderers, but compared to Almighty God, we just don't hold a candle. So the tax collector knew who he was, and he knew that God knew who he was. So his prayer was not an exercise in self-promotion. What his prayer was, my friends, and it's something that I need to learn, and I suspect most of us need to learn, his prayer was an open confession and a plea for what only God knew. only God can give, and that's holy mercy and divine forgiveness. He wasn't selling himself to God. No, if you hear his words, and you hear his anguish as he beats his chest, he's opening himself up and openly admitting to God, and if there were others in the temple, they heard it, openly admitting to them too, admitting his sin and the wrongdoing in his life. And Jesus says about him, it is this man who admitted his sin and asked for forgiveness, who went home justified. Now, justified is a good, big, theological word. And you use it all the way through the New Testament, and sometimes we understand what justified means, and sometimes we don't understand what justified means. But in this case, to justify means to be declared by the judge not guilty. To say it another way, it means to be declared right. The tax collector in this story is declared right in his relationship with God. While the Pharisee, think about that old Pharisee, while the Pharisee is who is so certain of his own righteousness, who is so certain of his own goodness and wants you to know it so quickly, who is so eaten up with how wonderful he is and he certainly doesn't want God to miss it, the Pharisee is declared guilty. Guilty because his relationship with God is wrong. He is not justified. He is not declared not guilty before the bar of God, before the bar of God's justice. And that bar of God's justice is the court of ultimate consequence. Now, if I'd have had good sense and thought about it ahead of time, I would have asked Johnny to stand up right here and give us a chain of how many courts you can appeal to before you finally run out of the appeal process. Well, God's court of consequence, that's the last court of appeal. Now, I don't want you to hear me say that the Pharisee was a bad person and that the tax collector was a really good person, because there is absolutely no suggestion of that in the parable. The Pharisee probably was pretty much a good and moral and generous person as he claimed to be, and when he gives his little speech there in chapter 18 about how he fasts and tithes and gives alms and prays frequently, he isn't guilty of false advertising. The Pharisees really did that. And there's no suggestion that he's a hypocrite pretending that he's doing something that he hasn't done, because he has done it. And the point of fact is, the Pharisees stood in great respect among the people of Israel because of their high standards of morality and their ethics. And I don't particularly like this word in church vernacular, but they were held in high standing because of their piety. On the other hand, we can't get anything from the scripture that says that the tax collector was really a good guy at heart. Someone like Robin Hood, who stole from the rich and gave to the poor. The tax collector probably was every bit as bad as his reputation made him out to be. In fact, had he not been crooked, and I find this an interesting fact, had he not been crooked, the Pharisee probably would not have been a tax collector in the first place. The tax collector would not have been a tax collector in the first place, because the Roman government could only get crooked people to be their lackeys and do what they wanted them to do. Therefore, it was the crooks that the Romans got to serve as tax collectors, Because they were interested in doing one thing only,